Blessings to everyone.
Blessings.
You know, just a day after I got here, I started losing my voice. So I thank the Lord that I'm able to talk today. I want to thank each and every one of you for your prayers. For me, the Lord has answered those prayers. And as we begin, I want to invite those of you who are able to kneel with me as we have a word of prayer. Gracious Father in heaven, I bless thee and thank thee, Lord, for the precious opportunity we have to gather together to hear thy word. And I pray thy Holy Spirit will impress our hearts, move upon our hearts, that we may have not only intellectual understanding, but an experiential understanding of these prophecies. I pray, Father, thou wilt fill our hearts full with thy Spirit, that we may have a love and a desire for truth within each and every bosom here. And I pray, Father, that thou wilt glorify thy word, that thy word may glorify thee this day. And bless thou thy servant, that he may speak those things that will exalt thee, that will bring thee honor and glory, and will uplift and exalt our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For this I ask in the blessed name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
My topic today that we'll be sharing is the seven seals. How many here are familiar with the seven seals, the book of Revelation? Well, the seven seals, and forgive me if you can't hear me. If you can't hear me, just let me know. I'll try to speak up as much as I can. I'll do my very best. But the seven seals are part of what we learned in the first evening, Tuesday evening, are part of the chains of prophecy. How many here are familiar with chains of prophecy? Those prophecies that are linked together, inseparably linked together. And the seven seals are among those chains of prophecy we find in the book of Revelation. The first of those, let's see. The first of them is found in the chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation, the seven churches. The seven churches are Christ's counsel to his church. It relates the whole history of the church from the beginning to the end. And in it, we find Christ's counsel to his church. And in these chains of prophecy we see in the book of Revelation, we find the way in which God works. What do I mean by that? Before God tells us how things are laid out, he gives us his counsel first. Before God requires of us to do a certain thing, he first tells us what he expects of us. He gives us counsel. He gives us instruction, and then he asks us to follow. He doesn't tell us to do something until he tells us what we are to do. And so we see that in the seven churches, God has revealed his counsel to his church, what he requires of them, what he asks of them. And in the seven seals, we see the playing out, how the church has heeded and unheeded that counsel. It is the outworking within the church of their heeding or not heeding the counsel of God. And tomorrow we'll be looking at the last of the three great chains of prophecy, the seven trumpets. And the seven trumpets are a chain, but they're a little different than the seals. Whereas the seals cover the history, the historical part of God's church, the trumpets deal with judgment, God's judgment against iniquity and apostasy, or more properly, against the mystery of iniquity as it is worked out within his church. The seven trumpets are God's judgment against that working out of the mystery of iniquity within his church. And for those who would like a bit more in-depth study on this subject, as one sermon is not enough to really cover these in detail, I want to invite you to read, if you haven't, the book Daniel and the Revelation written by Uriah Smith. Not just read it, study it. It's not enough to have a mental knowledge of these things, but God wants us to understand. We are to pray for wisdom. Wisdom is the principal thing, we're told in the book of Proverbs. We're to get it, but with all our getting, we're to get understanding. God wants us to understand the sense and the purpose of the prophecies, because prophecy is nothing more than the outworking of God's will in the earth. What God has said will come to pass. And prophecy is we see how that purpose of God has been wrought out in the world. And how many here are familiar with the idea of history repeating itself? We all know that history repeats itself. Do you know why? Why does history repeat itself?
Because there's nothing new under the sun.
There is nothing new under the sun. Turn with me to the book of Ecclesiastes. Yes.
The type and antitype.
Okay. Type and antitype.
Was, will be, or it shall be,
or something like that. Yes. Let's look at that. It's Proverbs chapter 1, or excuse me, not Proverbs, but Ecclesiastes chapter 1. Thank you. And we're going to look at verse 11. This is the reason why history repeats itself. And it's a lesson that we should never forget. Problem is, we've forgotten it. Verse 11 says, there is no remembrance of what?
Former things.
Former things. What would you call former things?
History. What's it?
History. History, yes. For there is no remembrance of history. Neither shall there be any remembrance of things that are to come with those that shall come after. Even in Solomon's day, they had forgotten their history. But Solomon says that in the days to come, those things that were to be fulfilled in the future would also be forgotten by those who would live in the future. And so history repeats itself. That's why there's nothing new under the sun, because we keep repeating the mistakes of our forefathers. Because we forget our history. Sister White, at the beginning of the crisis of our church in 1893, said we have nothing to fear for the future, but that we shall forget how the Lord has led us and His teaching in our past history.
That's right.
We have nothing to fear for the future, save this one thing. We forget.
That's right.
We forget. And I think we have much reason to fear today.
Yes.
Much reason to fear. Let's open our Bibles to Revelation chapter 6. Let's see if we can learn something that will help us not to repeat the lessons that are contained in the seven seals. Revelation chapter 6. We're going to begin with verses 1 and 2, the first seal. And before I read this, it would really do well to mention chapter 5 too. Because these seals would not be opened if it were not for the Lamb.
Yeah,
there would be no history of God's people if it were not for Jesus. Our history is because of Him. These things have played out by virtue of His sacrifice. If it were not for the sacrifice of God's dear Son, we would not have a history. None of us would be here. These seals are able to be opened, and the revelation, the outworking of God's purpose, is only able to be because of Christ. Through Christ alone, we have a hope of glory. And through Christ alone can we understand these things. And so I want us to understand that history isn't just something we should take for granted. History is granted to us because of the life and death and resurrection of God's Son. That's why we have history. Sometimes we take these things for granted and forget to realize that these things come through Christ. All things are through Him. Let us not forget that. Yes?
We would not have a book of Revelation because it's a revelation of Jesus Christ.
No, we wouldn't. You're right. There would be no revelation. There would be nothing. Everything hinged upon Christ. So with that, let's turn to Revelation chapter 6. Let's see how the principles we see in the seven churches, and unfortunately, that's not my message today, the seven churches. We're going to be looking at the seven seals. We're going to see how that council to those seven churches has played out in history. Verses 1 and 2 read, "And I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals," and the word "one" there could also be read "first." "I saw when the Lamb had opened one of the seals, and I heard, as it were, the noise of thunder, one of the four beasts saying, 'Come and see.' And I saw, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat on him had a bow, and a crown was given unto him, and he went forth conquering and to conquer." So we have a picture here. And sometimes, I know we as Adventists, I know myself, specifically or particularly, I'm a detail person. I love details. But when it comes to prophecy, you can't get immersed in details. You have to step back and look at the whole picture. Because what John saw was something living. He didn't see a painting like we have here. He saw something living, something moving, the outworking of something. It was living. And we can't forget that. Everything that we see here written out, these details, were part of one event. And the event has to be looked at as a whole. So sometimes we have to step back and look at everything. Sometimes we can't see the forest through the trees. And that's the way it is a lot of times with prophecy. Sometimes we get too caught up in the details and forget what the overall picture is. And when we look, when this first seal is opened, Christ reveals the first conquest, really, of his church. And it's represented by a white horse going forth, probably at high speed. And a man is sitting upon that horse. This man has a bow. And upon his head is a crown. Now that crown is not a diadem. It's not a kingly crown. It's what the Greek calls a stephanos, which is a wreath. It was the wreath that was given to the victors of the Olympic Games. One who overcame and was a victor. That's what this crown represents. So this person is not a king sitting up upon this horse. It's representing symbolic of one who overcomes. One who overcomes. Now, whiteness. When we think of whiteness, what do you think of?
Purity.
Purity, yes. Purity. So the white horse, the whiteness of the horse, would represent the purity of the gospel, the purity of the doctrine and the practice of those who went forth. Now, I've given a date here, and you'll notice that I've given no ending date. I don't know if you may have noticed that. I have a beginning date, but no ending date. And the reason being is that each of these seals, as they're opened, present the what we would call the most predominant or most forefront feature of the church. Would it be proper to say that God's church has ceased being pure or conquering? Some would say yes. But that would include you, wouldn't it? Has God's true church ever ceased being a conquering power in the world? No. That's why I've given no ending date. Because this is the prominent feature of the church as it presents itself on the scope of history, or on the stage of history, we might say. It presents itself in purity. Purity of teaching, purity of living. And God's church will always be this way. And when we return to the seventh seal, or the last part of the sixth seal and the seventh seal, we see a return to this white horse. Amen. God's church returns. He has always had a faithful few. Amen?
Amen?
God will always have faithful people who will keep his teachings and his practice purely. So the white horse represents purity. But we see also that this rider has a bow. Now when you think, today we might equate it as a tank or something like that. We have cavalry today, but it's a little different. When you think of a tank, it has ability to reach its foes at long distance and effectively. And this is the type of warfare that is pictured by this white horse, this man with a bow. He is an overcomer, and he conquers his foes in a particular manner. When you have a swift horse, and you have a man with a bow, in ancient times, this was the most effective mode of warfare. You could conquer your foes swiftly, rapidly, unexpectedly, and without any reprisal. So you have a swift, unexpected aspect here, as far as this bow is represented. But not only that, a bow is nothing without arrows, isn't it? So you have the gospel bow and arrows of truth. The truth, as it is in the Word of God, is that which is to penetrate the heart of those that hear the gospel. This crown, as I mentioned, represents the whole picture. This man is an overcomer. Were the apostles overcomers? Was Christ an overcomer? Yes, he was. All who will follow him will be overcomers. That is the nature of Christ's church. If we want to keep his doctrine and his practice in purity, we must overcome. We must overcome. So the crown represents conquest, not of others, but of self. Conquest of sin in the life is what is here represented. And we see that in the last aspect. He's going forth conquering and to conquer. And this phrase, conquering and to conquer, is very similar to what God said to Adam if he would eat of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil. Do you remember what he said? Thou shalt surely die. But in the Hebrew it reads, dying, thou shalt die. There's a surety there. In dying, there is no doubt, you will die. Because of sin, our bodies are corruptible. We will eventually die. And if we continue in that, our death will be certain. It will be eternal death. And the same thing is here. Conquering, he went forth conquering and to conquer. His conquering is sure if he remains pure. If we continue to conquer sin in our own lives, our conquest is sure. It is promised us. This is a promise to God's church. If we will practice what we preach and live what we preach and preach the Word of God, not what men may believe, not what men may think about the Word of God, but what the Word of God says, if we will let that be our life, if we will let that be the power behind us, then the promise to us is we too will go forth conquering, and in the end, we will conquer by the grace of Christ. And if you really want to understand the history, how this played out, well, you need to go back and read the Gospels and the book of Acts. But I'm going to share with you, actually, let me share this real quick. Just as a reference to this type of warfare, because we know that the warfare that the apostles waged was not one with swords or bows. It was not against flesh and blood, as the Apostle Paul said. But we wrestle against what?
Principalities.
Against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world. And when Jesus Christ sent forth his apostles, how did he do it? In John chapter 20, verse 22, remember he said that before he sent them out, he says, as my Father has sent me, so send I you. And then he did what? He breathed on them and said, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Before he sent his church out into the world, he empowered them. He gave them his Spirit. He said, as my Father has sent me, so send I you. Christ was sent in the Spirit of his Father. And so, when he sent his church out into the world, he breathed on them. The same power that God gave to his Son, Christ has given to you and me to ensure that we can conquer sin in our own lives. And that promise, if you read in Luke chapter 24, verse 49, Jesus calls this the promise of the Father. The promise of the Holy Ghost, or the Comforter, is the promise of the Father. And they were to wait for that promise. They were to come together, to pray together, to study together, until they received the promise. Why haven't we received the latter rain? The promise is ours. If you will pray together and study together and come into harmony together, the promise was ours. Why haven't we received it? Well, I think the answer should be obvious. And 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 4 through 5, the Apostle Paul tells us that our weapons are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of what?
Strongholds.
What strongholds? The casting down of imaginations, right? And every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing every thought into captivity. To whom? To Christ. This is the warfare that God wants us to conduct. It was the warfare of the apostles, and that is why it is symbolized as a white horse. Let me read you this quote. I love this quote. It's written by a man named Alexander Keith. He wrote a book called Signs of the Times. Usually you find it in two volumes. And in this book, he describes this portion of history in this language. And I think it's some of the most beautiful language describing this portion of the church's history. And you can see the outworking of this vision that was given to John of the white horse in these words. He says, "When his gospel was first preached, Christ was believed on in the world. He came to make an end of what?
Sin.
And to bring in everlasting, what's that word?
Righteousness.
And righteousness is? Right doing. He took part of flesh and blood, that through death he might destroy him that had power over death, that is the devil. Satan was beheld to fall before him like lightning from heaven. The kingdom of God was preached unto the world. Power to become the sons of God was promised to them that believed and received him. He who reigns by righteousness sought for himself a kingdom from among the sinful children of men. And in a world enslaved by sin, he went forth to conquer." Who went forth to conquer? Jesus. "Never on earth was there a triumph of light over darkness, of righteousness over iniquity. Never did the power of Satan sustain such a shock as at the time when the men of understanding who knew their God instructed many, when the apostles of the Lord Jesus and all the first preachers of the gospel went forth to convert a world lying in wickedness, established Christian churches in every land, and not with carnal weapons of their warfare, but strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, themselves fought as they taught others to fight the good fight of faith, and as the servants of Jesus conquered sin, which till then had held the world in unredeemed slavery and unchallenged dominion." That is the history of the church under the apostles of Jesus Christ, and beginning with Jesus Christ, because without him none of these things would be possible. He was, as I believe, the one represented on that horse. Christ was the one who overcame that we might overcome by his grace and through faith in him. But the vision doesn't end there. Sadly, I wish it did, but it doesn't. It continues. Let's read verses 3 and 4 of Revelation chapter 6. "And when he had opened the second seal, I heard the second beast say, Come and see. And there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that sat thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword." Do you see a change? Mm-hmm. We have a horse. We have a rider still, don't we? Mm-hmm. But what has changed?
The color.
One of the rules of interpretation that I think is imperative to follow, especially when within the confines of a prophecy, we need to be consistent. If whiteness of the horse represented purity of doctrine and practice, then what would a departure from that whiteness represent? Departure from purity in doctrine and practice, right? This horse is red. And now, if white represents a pure, healthy body, what happens when you see a red swelling on your flesh? What does that mean?
Infection.
Your body is fighting off an infection. That's what it means. This horse is not red as in scarlet, kokinon, as the Greek translate, or that's the Greek word for it. It's the word puros, which means fiery red. Inflamed is the actual word. It's an inflamed red because something has infected the church. The body of Christ has been infected. So we see the color to be consistent. If white is pure and healthy, red means you've lost that. You've been compromised. And that's why I call this phase the church of compromise. Because now, no longer is conquering sin the predominant feature of the church, but compromise has now become the predominant feature. And I've given a date as around 60 AD, and you'll see why I give that date in a moment. But redness, as I mentioned, compromise. Compromise brings in infection. When your skin or your body's immune system is compromised, redness, inflammation, itis is the result. And the result of that compromise is that peace would be taken from the earth. And when the prophet says earth, he doesn't simply mean the whole globe. It's in respect to the scope of the prophecy. What was the then known world? It was the Roman Empire. Was the then known world. That was the world then. And so when he's talking about taking peace from the world, it's in respect to the Roman world. Peace from the Roman Empire was taken as the result of the church's compromise. So at whose feet lays the responsibility for all the wickedness in this world? The church. God holds us responsible for it. Our compromise has brought all the wickedness into the world and has justified men in their wickedness. Christ condemned sin in the flesh because he lived a sinless life. He overcame for us that we too, by his grace, might overcome and condemn sin in this flesh. Is that your desire? I hope so. But when we compromise that purity of doctrine and that purity of practice, we not only bring infection to this body, but into everyone else. You know, when you're sick, you don't just affect yourself, do you? But others. I'm sure we're all aware of that fact. Disease is spread from one to another. God holds the church responsible for the infection in this world. It took peace from the earth. And this was because when they compromised, they began to wrangle about doctrine. And it was that wrangling over doctrine that brought these controversies. And we'll see that historically in just a moment. But I'm going to note, first of all, these different characteristics. It causes all men, or he who rode upon the horse, causes all men to kill one another. The men of the Roman Empire. So this compromise would result in men killing one another. Bloodshed would be the result. And we will see that historically. And this is directly relating because at this time of the church, or shortly thereafter, was when the church sought union with the state. And we'll see that as well. And a great sword was given him. Now, what's the difference between a sword and a bow? Are both weapons?
Yes.
Do you kill people with both?
Brains.
Yes. Well, what's the difference?
Brains.
One is straight to the point. And the other just hacks away. It's a weapon of division. Not of truth. Which truth gets right to the point and strikes the heart. Just like a bow. But a sword divides. The weapon at this church, it's a conquering church, but it's conquering in all the wrong ways. Its weapon is divisive. It's causing division, separation, and schism within the body. Sword is a weapon of dividing. You cut things with it. You divide parts with it. Notice this quote. God permits us to be placed under circumstances that will test us, to increase our love and to perfect our trust in him. Why does God allow us to be tested? To perfect our trust in him, yes. Through what? Self-denial and suffering with Christ. We grow in grace and in the knowledge of the truth. Trials will come. Now that's a promise. Yeah. All who will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. That is a promise. If you will live by your convictions, and those convictions are according to the word of God, persecution will come to you. But notice this last. But they are an evidence that we are the children of God. Persecution is an evidence that we are the children of God. Persecution for truth's sake, that is. When we hold the truth and preach the truth, you're going to be persecuted if you will live godly in Christ Jesus. But the promise is that you may know that you are a son of God or daughter of God. Tests come, but they come to test us, that God may be glorified in our test. When the test comes, it's because God wants us to glorify Him. Are we willing? Are we willing that God should be justified? That every man, as it says in Romans 3:4, that every man should be a liar and that God may be true. Are you willing that God may be true in your life? Notice this statement as well. This is taken from Scripture. 2 Thessalonians, should have the 2 there. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. Why did God allow test and trial to come to His church? Paul tells us that even in his day, and this was probably around the year 57 to 60 AD, for the mystery of iniquity doth already work, he said. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. The mystery of what?
Iniquity.
What is iniquity?
Sin.
Lawlessness. Lawlessness is the definition of sin. In 1 John 3:4, sin is called the transgression of the law. That word transgression of the law is taken from the Greek word anomia, which means lawlessness. Lawlessness was working in the days of Paul in the church. It began its work. And the reason why God brought persecution was to cleanse. When you get that inflammation, it's because your body is trying to purge out that which has infected it. God is trying to cleanse His church. That's why tests and trials come, so that it may be purified. Paul also wrote in the book of Acts, this is not Paul's writings, Luke wrote the book of Acts. Here he records the words of Paul to those of Miletus and Ephesus. Acts chapter 20, verses 29 and 30. It says, "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own self shall men arise, speaking what?
Perverse
things. What are perverse things?
Contrary to the gospel.
What's that?
Contrary to the gospel.
Okay. Perverse means twisted. Something that is twisted was once first straight. Perverse is a twisting of truth. When you take an arrow and you bend it, it no longer flies straight. It's perverted. It will no longer hit the target. That's why Paul says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned, and the result is they come short or miss the mark of the glory of God." Sin causes us to become perverted. We cannot hit the target any longer. Paul said that he knew that grievous wolves would enter in, not sparing the flock. That they would speak perverse things. They would take the truth and twist it. Why? To draw away disciples after themselves. People who like to draw attention to themselves, who want a crowd, want a following. Paul saw this danger. He calls it the mystery of iniquity. It was working in his day, and it's working in ours. God foresaw this danger. He warned His people of this danger. We need to know this book like never before. You know, I used to have a friend who worked in the FBI, and he was in the counterfeit bill division. And his job was to teach men how to recognize not counterfeit bills, but the genuine. He studied it with them. They studied every minute detail of a genuine, every denomination of American currency. They studied it. in detail. They knew every minute detail of that bill so that they could recognize a counterfeit. You don't study the counterfeit. You study the original. You know it in minute detail is the only safeguard against deception. Paul saw the deception. That's why he admonished Timothy before his death in 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. God wants us to know his word so that we can be on guard against deception, because wolves have not ceased entering in. They're entering in today, and we need to be wary. I love these next two quotes. In Revelation 3:19, Jesus, speaking to the church of Laodicea, says, "As many as I love, I what? Rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and what?
Repent."
A rebuke is a trial, isn't it? It's difficult sometimes to take a rebuke and chastening, especially when it's public. But Jesus says, "As many as I love, I what? I rebuke and chasten." Why does he do that? Because he wants us to repent. He wants us to change our minds. Notice what Paul says in Hebrews 12:8. "But if ye be without what?" If you are not chastised, if you do not receive chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye
bastards
and not sons. God wants us to be sons, not bastards. He doesn't want us to be fatherless, the illegitimate children of fornication. He wants us to be children of Christ, the one to whom we have been betrothed. We are to receive chastisement that we might be corrected and turn from our wickedness to righteousness. And if we don't receive that chastisement, then we know that we are not sons, not of Christ, but of another whore. I want to go through this quickly. How all this played out. In 67 AD, history tells us that the 10 great persecutions began against the Church of God. They lasted from 67 AD to around 313 AD, which is when the persecutions officially ended against Christianity. Now, why did that persecution come? Well, because of compromise. Remember why God brings test? To purge and cleanse? The church had compromised, and so persecution came in 67, beginning in 67 AD. Beginning around 100 AD, for the next 150 years, pagan philosophy and teaching began to enter into the church. No more were men who loved the word of God ordained as elders and bishops in the church, but men who had a love for philosophy, for theoretical ideas and concepts, began to enter into the church. Men who were lovers of Plato and Socrates, who preferred philosophical ideas. Men like Origen, who said that he refused to teach the gospel unless it was mixed with Socrates and Plato. This compromise resulted in, well, let's see. In Egypt, the result of this entering in of Grecian and other ethnic philosophies brought in what was known as asceticism. Anyone here know what asceticism is? What is asceticism, Caleb?
Asceticism is the mixing of Christ, the human and the divine, emphasizing one over the other. No, that's asceticism, sorry.
What's that?
I was confusing with asceticism.
Oh, okay, yes. Anyone else know what asceticism is? Asceticism, also we know in English as monasticism, or I prefer to call it monkery, because that's what it is. And it's a development of this pagan philosophy that entered into the church. And it entered in between the years 100 and 254 AD. Compromise. These persecutions were increased. Because right around the close or the mid part of the 3rd century, the barbarians of the north began to invade the Roman Empire. God was testing his church, bringing in trial. In 306, beginning of 306, for the next 7 years, as a result of this compromise, and the loss of the power of the gospel, the power of truth, the church sought a union with the state. Thus, it resulted in the Christianization of the state, nominally that is, and of the secularization of the church. Also, at the end of the persecution, the years of persecution, there was a controversy that arose within the church over those who compromised during that time period, or maybe burnt incense to another god, or whatever they may have done to not receive persecution. There was a controversy over there. It's called the Donatist controversy. And I only mention it for the reason that the result of that Donatist controversy is important. The result was that those who would remain true became known as Catholic. Yes. Those who had apostatized, according to many, were labeled as
heretics.
Those who remained true became called themselves Catholic. This was soon followed by another controversy. Remember taking peace from the earth? It was called the Arian controversy. And I mentioned this, we all know the result of the Arian controversy, don't you? What was the result of the Arian controversy? It established the Orthodox faith in the church. The Nicene Creed, or the Athanasian Creed. It established what we call orthodoxy, the right teaching within the church. That was the result of the Arian controversy. And it was a result of compromise with pagan philosophy. Shortly thereafter, 321 was the first Sunday law. Then we have the Council of Nicaea, 325. As I mentioned, the church has become Catholic at this time. I mentioned that one as well. And the last was the result of this controversy. It's not only split the church, but it resulted in bloodshed. Thousands, maybe tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands lost their lives because of this doctrinal controversy. And it wasn't established until 381 AD, which is when the Catholic or Orthodox faith became established in 381 AD. And so during this whole phase of the church, we see this compromise and what it brought. It took peace from the earth. It caused men to kill one another. We see the sword in the hand of this writer. And to help us understand, I'm going to quote here Eusebius, because he explains, let's skip here. He explains how this worked out in his day. Now, he was a contemporary to the Council of Nicaea. He wrote in the early part of the 4th century. And speaking of that time, he says, "But when, by reason of excessive liberty, we sunk into negligence and sloth, one envying and reviling another in different ways, and we were almost, as it were, on the point of taking up arms against each other, and were assailing each other with words, as with darts and spears, prelates inveighing against prelates, and people rising up against people, and hypocrisy and dissimulation had arisen to the greatest height of malignity." Now notice, this is in the early part of the 4th century AD. And he says this happened whilst multitudes were yet crowding into the church. They were still converting people, but converting them to what? He continues, "Some indeed, like atheists, regarding our situation as unheeded and unobserved by a providence, that is, by God, we added one wickedness and misery to another. But some that appeared to be our pastors, deserting the law of piety and inflamed against each other with mutual strifes, only accumulating quarrels and threats, rivalship, hostility and hatred to each other, only anxious to assert the government as a kind of sovereignty for themselves. Thus we see the point to which the church had come at the time of Eusebius, and thus brings in the third phase of the church that we see in verses 5 and 6. Revelation 6, verses 5 and 6. And when he had opened the third seal, I heard the third beast say, "Come and see." And I beheld, and lo, a black horse. And he that sat on him had a pair of balances in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts say, "A measure of wheat for a penny, and three measures of barley for a penny. And see thou hurt not the oil and the wine." What was the result? What now becomes the dominant feature in the church? I call it the church of empire. Because now, once the church had united with the state, it sought to form an empire, like that which it united with. And the beginning time of this would be 381. After all the controversies had ended, after the Orthodox faith had been established, now the church set on a new course. And that course was to dominate the world. And thus the horse became black. If white is pure, red is infected, black is what? Yes. Or close to it. The truth is cast out. If white is light, black is the what? The absence of light. Truth had been cast out, utterly cast out of the church. That's the prominent feature. Now we know that, has compromise ceased? No. Has conquering ceased? No, but it's no longer the prominent feature, you see. Now, empire building has become the prominent feature in the church. And we see that in this description. This rider has scales in his hands. What are scales used for?
Measuring?
Weighing
the money that they get.
Yes. Scales were used for monetary transactions. You weighed out money in the balance. It's a picture here of worldliness within the church. The church was selling the gospel for gain. Yep. It was selling its truth for gain. The same word, zugon, which is translated scales, is also the same word that's used for yoke. And I think it a fitting symbol, because the church was yoking the world to itself, binding them in slavery to sin and corruption, rather than binding them to Christ in righteousness. And we have a kind of an addition to this symbol of buying and selling, where the wheat and the barley were sold for a penny. You have the spiritual truths of the gospel being sold to the highest bidder. Sold for temporal gain. But there's hope. Because we hear a voice that says, "See thou hurt not the oil and the wine." God promised that the graces of the Christian life would be protected. Purity and nobility of character would be protected. The genuine piety and the Christian graces were to be preserved. God says, "See thou hurt not." God's promise was that these things would be preserved within his church. Even though corruption had reached such a state that the horse was considered black, yet God says these Christian graces would be preserved. Can you say amen?
Amen.
That's why we are here today, because God has preserved these things for us. And we see the outworking of these things in history. We see that the Roman Empire was divided in the year 395. The result of that was that the empire was divided from east to west, which meant that the Roman emperors of the east, who were the stronger emperors, were removed from the west, where the church had its seat. So So the church was really free at that point, free from the intervention of the state to a great degree. In 476, the Western Empire fell to the barbarians. In 493, one of those barbarian tribes was uprooted, according to Daniel chapter 7. The Herulians were uprooted in 493. All these things add to the church becoming an empire. In the year 496, Clovis, who was king of the Franks, was converted to Catholic Christianity. The result was that in the year 508, he had eradicated paganism from Europe. Europe became Catholic. Next, in 533, the Arian Vandals were uprooted, again making way for the rise of the man of sin. The Arian Ostrogoths were next uprooted. In 600, the language of the Bible was locked into the common vernacular of Rome, Latin. In 9, the ninth point, we have the massacre at Bangor in Wales. How many here are familiar with this event? Anybody know what this event took place? Well, in order for the church to become empire, she had to remove all her rivals. The first rival to perish was paganism. The second rival that had to be taken out of the way was true Christianity. And the strongest seat of true Christianity at that time was in England. That's where Celtic Christianity had prospered and become a vibrant source of missionary activity, not only in England, but in all of Europe. And so Augustine was sent there in the 4th century, or actually in the 5th and 6th century. And the result was that he brought out the leaders of the Celtic Church to a supposed meeting. And in that meeting, he had already conspired with the pagan Saxons, or Catholic Saxons, I should say, at that time. He conspired with them to massacre the leaders of the Celtic Church. And this was in 620. So essentially, the Celtic Christianity was dismantled at that time.
Who did that?
That was the result specifically of Augustine, who went as the missionary to England. He was considered a missionary to England, but he went there to establish Catholicism in England, and he succeeded.
Different Augustine then?
Yes. A different one, yes. In the 8th century is the next event, and this is called the Iconoclastic War. And I wish I had a lot more time to go into that, but the Iconoclastic War was a war over images. It was a war between the Eastern Emperor and the Pope of Rome over whether images should be worshipped or not. And it was a test to see who would overcome. Who would be really the leader and dominant force in Christianity? And it was decided that the Pope would be the dominant figure. The papacy prevailed in this war over the worship of images. The result was that in 800 AD, Charlemagne was crowned the emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. So now, all of Rome's enemies were gone. And it was now time for her to have her own empire. And this came about in the year 800 AD. Just 29 years later, in a council, the bishops, and according to official church canon, asserted their right to judge princes, that is, earthly rulers, their temporal power. And shortly thereafter, and after another 30 years, they made themselves the sole judges of all the clergy. Mm-hmm. No earthly prince could judge the clergy. They could only be judged by bishops. So they were now excluded from external intervention. And they voted themselves exempt from secular control, as I mentioned. And the last, and perhaps one of the most important, was the War of Investiture, which after the power had changed from the Romans, where the church had united with the Roman power, after that Roman power was destroyed by the barbarians, they sought unity with the barbarians. They united with the barbarian kings. And those barbarian kings sought to assert their authority. And they claimed the right of investiture, which was to ordain bishops and the pope. The kings claimed that right, according from Constantine, that he was the one who gave them that power. And the pope challenged that, and the result was the War of Investiture. And the result of that war was that the papacy won out once again. The pope not only had right to ordain his own clergy, but he had the right to ordain the emperor and to crown him. So now the emperor had to come and bow at the feet of the Roman pontiff to receive his crown. So thus, by the 11th century AD, the church had become empire at its highest point. And that leads to the next. We'll skip this quote. But there were some bright... Remember I said that there would be those who would maintain the Christian graces within the church? We see men such as Helvidius and Jovinian and Vigilantus in the continent, in Europe. There are also men in England and in Scotland and Ireland, men like Patrick and Columba. There's also Dinuth and Columbanus and Aidan. All these men held these Christian graces, and through them, the truth of the gospel remained. It was kept in its purity. Through these men, these truths were committed to a people that we know today as the Waldenses. It was through, because of these men, that we have this book. God preserved these things for us when all this corruption was abounding. When the church was seeking empire, God was preserving his word and his truth and the graces of his spirit in the church. And if you want to know more about this, I would invite you to read this wonderful book called Truth Triumphant by Benjamin G. Wilkinson. If you haven't read it, I think you will be blessed by reading it. And the fourth seal, a pale horse. Verse 7 and 8. And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth beast say, "Come and see." And I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed with him. And power was given unto them over the fourth part of the earth, to kill with sword, and with hunger, and with death, and with the beasts of the earth. So now the church becomes the church of persecution. Now that it had become empire, its predominant feature was that to persecute anything and everything that was opposed to it. Anything that might be considered a rival was crushed ruthlessly. And thus the church, and the writer thereon, his name is Death, aptly named. And hell and the grave followed behind him. Death and the grave. In history, we see this is the very time, immediately after the War of Investiture, the church embarked on some of the most bloodiest campaigns that warfare has seen, known as the Crusades. For 200 years, nearly, from the 11th century to the 13th century. In that same century, or just a century later, was established the Inquisition. You can see why it's called the Church of Persecution. Next was the Albigensi Crusade, those who were of the true faith in France. They were known as the Albigenses. For the next half a century, were persecuted by this church. At the same time, there was a crusade led against the Waldenses. I put in here the Black Plague. Because I believe that plague was the direct result of this spirit within the church. Had they been following the truths of the gospel, that plague would never have come to pass. In 1415, perhaps the most crucial event in this time period was the martyrdom of John Huss, because it was that event that ignited the Reformation. Shortly after him, the year after, in the same Council of Constance, Jerome was martyred. He was a contemporary with John Huss. Shortly thereafter was the Hussite War, where the Catholic Church sought to crush those who had rose up in support of John Huss. It was unsuccessful, though. Point nine was another crusade against the Waldenses. 1536, William Tyndale is martyred. 1540, 4 years after, the Counter-Reformation establishes the Jesuit order. And the Waldensian massacre at Marindal in 1545, when 10,000 were slaughtered. Michael Servetus in 1553. This is one of the saddest, because this man was not put to death by the Catholic Church, but by John Calvin, a Protestant. Ridley and Latimer in England, some of the more prominent martyrs of England. And so we can see during this time period how fitly represented the church is as a persecutor. Once she gained her power, she exercised it with zeal. And in 1572, at the close of this time, you have the St. Bartholomew Massacre, where over 30,000 were slain. In the book by J.A. Wiley, he kind of sums up this time period with these words. He says, "Pagan Rome shed the blood of the saints, but papal Rome was drunk with the blood of the saints. The three centuries that preceded the Reformation were one continued massacre. The armed force of Western Europe, led on by Rome, was employed to crush a peaceful and industrious, a virtuous and a loyal people, guiltless but for the crime of refusing to bow the knee to the Dagon of the Seven Hills." And thus we have the fifth seal. Now, I don't have time to go through the fifth seal in detail, nor the sixth or seventh. The fifth seal, everything changes. You have the symbols change. Instead of seeing a horseman with a rider, you see an altar. And you see, according to Scripture, the souls of those who had perished for the word of God. Verse 9. We see the souls of those under this altar that were slain for the word of God and the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth?" And so thus the church changes. It becomes the church of vindication. At the time that the church was ruthlessly persecuting, God raised up a movement that would vindicate his name, that would vindicate all those who had suffered under the hands of Rome, all those who had died as heretics, who had gone to the grave with their reputation, their names blackened by infamy, who had been labeled as heretics and monsters and demons and everything vile that you could think of, simply because they stood for the word of God. But because the word of God had been held back from people and they didn't know the truth, they thought that these people had died as enemies of the church. And their names had been blackened. And here, in symbolic language, it's as if their blood is speaking to God for vindication. Mm-hmm. And not only for their own vindication, but for the vindication of the truth. And thus, the church enters its fifth stage, which is the stage of vindication. And that was the time period we know as the Reformation. And that's why I've given it the time of 1381. Anyone know what happened in 1381? Was the year the first English Bible was given to the people. It was the Wycliffe Bible. It was the product of the Morning Star of the Reformation. And it heralded the vindication, because the Word of God was once again given to the people of God, that they could read and know these things for themselves. And it's through that Word, above all things, I'm going to skip over the historical details, but the result of that time period was that God gave to His people the Word in their own tongue. Not only to us English-speaking people, but to people all around the world. They were given to read the Word of God in their own language. No longer was it locked up in some sacred tongue, but everyone could read it and understand it for themselves. It was through the reading of the Word of God that the characters of these men who had died as martyrs for the truth were vindicated. They saw that they died for the truth. Men began to read the Word of God, and they saw the hypocrisy of the church. They saw that those who had died for martyrs, as martyrs of the truth, and their names, their characters were vindicated. Thus God's cause was vindicated. His church was vindicated. And as I quoted there, Psalm 107:20, some of the most beautiful words in the Psalms. He sent His word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. How true. No other work, no other book has had such a profound influence. No other book can heal as can the Word of God. God sent His Bible to heal them, and that it did. And thus we have the sixth stage of the seal, or sixth stage of the church, excuse me. Verses 12. It says, And I beheld when he opened the sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood, and the stars of heaven fell into the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. And the heaven departed as a scroll when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island removed out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and rich men, and chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said unto the mountains and rocks, Fall on us, and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. Thus enters in the church of the Advent. Not only the church of the Advent movement, but the church of the Advent of Christ. Because it's this seal that under and in the time of this seal that God's people are sealed, that they are made fit for Christ at His coming. We see the great earthquake, which occurred in the year 1755. There was also the sun and moon darkened. 1780, and the falling of the stars, as when a fig tree is shaken and she casteth her untimely figs, in the year 1833. All of these things are past. The very next event, it says, the heavens depart as a scroll. Mountains and islands are removed, and men seek shelter from the wrath of God. So we can see that we are between the third and the fourth. This is where we stand in the history of the world, between this third point and the fourth. We've passed 1833, haven't we? The world has seen or felt the earthquake. It's seen the sun and moon, or the sun darkened, the moon become as blood, and it's seen the stars fall from heaven. The next event is the departing of the heavens as a scroll. And so we stand at the pivotal moment. And as much as I would like, chapter 7 really belongs together with chapter 6. Because chapter 7 tells us what happens during this time. The sealing of God's people. An angel is seen descending with the seal of the living God, whereby he seals God's people in preparation for that event, the departing of the heavens as a scroll, which then prepares for the church in its final and complete stage. God's people are sealed. They have returned once again to the purity of the faith and the practice of God's word in truth. They've returned as a conquering horse, as that conquering rider, I should say. The church once again returns to its purity of practice and truth. This we saw in the Advent people. And all those who are sealed under that message, yes, will also have those white garments, yes, will follow Christ in purity and in truth. And as a result of that, the church enters into its seventh phase, the complete phase, the phase of perfection, or the church, I call, of eternity. Because there's just one verse for this one. It's a quick and easy one to read. It's Revelation chapter 8, verse 1. What happens as a result of the opening of the seventh seal? It says there's silence in heaven for the space of half an hour. In prophetic time, how long is half an hour?
7 days.
7 days, yes. I want to share with you a quote. I believe the 7 days represents the time we journey to heaven. Spirit prophecy tells us this in the book Early Writings, page 16. Then Jesus' silver trumpet sounded as he descended on the cloud wrapped in flames of fire. Then it tells us, we all entered the cloud together and were 7 days ascending to the sea of glass. Why was there silence in heaven for 7 days? I believe it's because it's that time period where all heaven is emptied. And we are journeying with Christ to meet God in heaven. Yes?
Seven is the complete number also.
It is the complete number. And it ushers in eternity. Thus the church is ushered in to eternity. And I hope that that's each and every desire in your breast, in everyone here today. Because we've just looked, and this is just an outline. The seven seals are simply an outline. The rest of the book of Revelation fleshes out that history and reveals the details, those things that the difficulties and trials that the Church of God will have to endure during its history, its long history. And specifically those that relate to us today. But that'll have to save for another time. But if it's your desire to be a part of the Church of Eternity, to be a part of those who Christ will come to claim as his own, those who will see God face to face, if it's your desire to have peace and joy, to know no more sickness, no sorrow, nor death, nor pain, then I want to invite you to kneel together with me in the word of prayer. Gracious Father in heaven, I thank thee for thy word. I thank thee for the prophecies that thou hast given us, that we might know where we stand. And more than this, that we might know the duties that devolve upon us as thy people, that we might know what thou dost require of us in this, our day. And I pray, Father, that that sealing work may be accomplished in each and every one of us, that when those heavens shall depart as a scroll, that when Christ shall come to claim his own, it may find us faithful, that Jesus may find faith in the earth. And I pray that thou wilt bless us. Help us, Father, to be faithful, faithful unto the end. Help us not to grow weary of well-doing, but to be strong in grace and in the power of thy might, that we might go forth as pictured in the opening seal as a conquering force in this world to conquer sin and death in our lives and through us in the lives of others. I pray, Father, that thou wilt use us to save souls. Help us, Father, to be as vessels of light in this world and as salt in this world, that our lives may vindicate thee, that it may be seen that thou art true, and that thy law is holy and just and good. Bless us as we go forth, that we be not forgetful hearers, but that we may be doers of thy word. For this I ask in Jesus' blessed name. Amen.